We were trying to get in touch with the mayor for quite some time. She finally made that call, and we immediately took action.
Governor Larry Hogan last night talking about his decision to declare Baltimore a state of emergency, call in the National Guard, notify the president, and all of the legal things that go along with declaring a state of emergency. You heard in his tone there, we were very happy that the mayor finally called. We've been trying to get in touch with her. Joining us right now is former Maryland Governor Bob Ehrlich, who sat in that same seat that Governor Hogan sits in. Thanks for joining us this morning, Mr. Governor.
Hey, Brian. Hey, Larry. How you doing?
Pretty good. You know, we had your Lieutenant Governor, Michael Steele, on yesterday. And one of the things, because I said, you know, what's it like? You were a Lieutenant Governor in Annapolis in a post-9/11 world. I'm sure you had a lot of contingencies for things like this.
Yeah.
He said, you know, the one thing you can be assured of is that the mayor and the governor, communication is very clear, and I'm sure they're checking in with each other and they're communicating. When you hear the frustration in Larry Hogan's voice there, what's your response?
Well, my response is, and I know Larry very well, obviously, you heard the frustration, and so my response would be unacceptable.
Yeah.
And Larry's diplomatic way, his response was the same.
Well, hold on a minute. I need to understand how this works, because I heard some pretty, you know, direct criticism on some of the media coverage. Why hasn't the governor sent in the National Guard? What is he waiting for? Well, I want you to run through for me, what are the protocols in a situation like that? Could you, as governor, send in the National Guard without consulting with the mayor?
Well, it's not advisable.
Well, sure. Tell us why.
You know, the governor, well, listen, protocol first, but now let's get real. Let's get into the real world. It's Baltimore City. You have in the aftermath of Ferguson and some of the events around the country, you know, race as an issue. You're going to be careful here, but you're also going to do your job. So I think that balancing of interests is why you heard the frustration in Larry's voice. Let me also, guys, say this. Politicians, this is art, not science, and politicians make mistakes. And I am not going to condemn the mayor for the words she chose the other day, because I think she didn't mean the words she chose.
Yeah.
The problem is they didn't walk it back. They let those words hang. No member of her staff stepped forward and said, hey, we're going to have another press conference, or the mayor did not mean this. She meant dissent, not destruction.
Right.
And so the problem was not the original mistake. The problem was it never got walked back. And now it looks like one narrative here is she invited some of this, which obviously was not her choice, but she let herself open to this criticism by not walking it back.
We're seeing a lot of the organizers of the protests, not the rioters, but the protests that sort of, you know, were the precursor to these riots. They're going on cable news and they're talking about the Martin O'Malley administration back when he was mayor of Baltimore. And at that time, you were governor of Maryland, and they're saying that, you know, he used some tactics there to under the guise of stopping crime that ended up really creating some resentments.
I'm not going to reprise the second campaign, the 2010 race, but this was an issue in that race, and I made it an issue because, as you know, criminal justice reform is my issue, and I thought how they went about this was wrong. Arresting lots of innocent people was the wrong way to go about their goal. It was an issue in the campaign, and he won. So obviously enough people did not agree with me on that, or at least feel strongly enough that that was the wrong way to go.
Oh, yeah, and I'm not trying to drag into the political discussion.
Yeah, I don't want to reinvent that, but the fact of it is, a lot of innocent people, and it was well reported. NAACP obviously got involved, and there was all sorts of exposés by the Sun and the Post. But the fact of it is that left some lingering resentment, no doubt about it.
Do you think that the curfew should have been imposed earlier?
Of course. I don't understand, guys. I don't understand that decision. My suspicion is the police were very tired, and the assets were not in place for some reason, and they were fearful of calling a curfew that they could not enforce. That's my suspicion, but again, that goes to lack of preparation, if that was the reason.
Well, you mentioned that you're not going to criticize the mayor for her words about saying we left room for the destroyer.
I'm going to criticize her for not walking back.
Fair enough, but when you look at what happened last night, it seems that that's exactly what she did. The police were instructed to hang back. She left the people room to do exactly what she said she was going to let them do, which was give them space to destroy.
Well, this is, I assume this was a post-Ferguson syndrome. That the criticism Ferguson was heavy police presence, militarism, everybody freaking out about that, so let's go the other way. And obviously this didn't work either, and there are a lot of people waking up in Baltimore City today without their properties, their business owners, their homes, and they're going to be asking some tough questions, believe me.
Can I ask just one more question? Do you were you around in 68? Do you remember anything about the 68?
I do. I was 11 years old. I remember this.
It was different then, wasn't it? Because there were some people who stood on street corners with shotguns, and entire neighborhoods were protected, were they not?
Yes, but everything was different then. You know, that was the civil rights movement. There was obviously violence, but this is... This is a case where maybe somebody screwed up, and you have to let the process play itself out.
Yeah.
And the way you don't react is to trash somebody's business and throw police lives in danger. It just it loses all sense of credibility, all sense, none, zero, no rationalizations here, no excuses, no defense.
Our guest is former Maryland Governor Bob Ehrlich, and we're talking about, obviously, the situation in Baltimore. What about the way forward, setting aside the riots, because, you know, this is going to play out, and hopefully now that the National Guard is in, the curfew is in, the violence is going to calm down. But what about what can actually be done to improve the lives of the people in Baltimore who obviously have some sense of grievance with their elected officials?
Listen, here's what drives me to distraction. I drove those streets. I drive those streets regularly. I'm a West Baltimore kid. I cut through the city on the way back to my home in Annapolis. Compton University, I was very close to as governor, right down the street, producing middle-class jobs for the city. I mean, there are lots of positives here. There are a lot of positive people. There are real leaders. There are pastors who really have credibility in the community. Those folks have to step forward and look to the extent the situation with the death here, it's going to play itself out. It's process. You have to believe in the process. If there are issues, which there are, concerning economic empowerment and entrepreneurism, the way not to do it is to burn down businesses that are hiring your community.
Yeah,
and so there I think there has to be, you lose all sense of empathy when you see this, because some of these neighborhoods, by the way, impacted last night, you saw some, you're beginning to see some rebirth. There were businesses moving back, creating the jobs people talk about, and now they're trashed. It's crazy. And I think the good people, the community leaders, have to step forward and say, unacceptable. Under no circumstances is acceptable. None.
All right. Thank you.
That's where we start.
Thank you for joining us. Baltimore's own and Maryland's own former Governor Bob Ehrlich. Thanks for joining us.
My pleasure.
Unfortunately, a sad day in Maryland.
Embarrassing day as well.